this is Steve with Salt Zine. Thanks for coming back. Well, this time we're going to talk a little bit about, a whole lot, about a crate dig I did not far from my house. Down the street, there's a place called Checkered Past. I decided to go out of business. It's kind of basically an antique store. I had some decent stuff in there, but not really enough. Wasn't keeping enough stuff in there, good enough stuff to keep doors open, I guess. Had a lot of neon. And he had this big boy that was about this big. That was kind of cool. I don't know what you'd do with that, except maybe put it in a big garage or something. That's kind of cool. Or if you're really daring, put it on your back patio or your front porch. But I don't know what he did with that. Didn't see it in there while I was in there. The records, they were, you know, like a lot of places, weren't very well taken care of. One of them was on a big metal shelf, and of course the middle shelf was caving in, and so you couldn't hardly look at the record very well. Everything was dirty. Some of them were in boxes, of course. Some of them were on this big wooden shelf where they'd always just fall over, or, you know, bend over, you know, be like major angles, or falling off the edge of the off the end of the shelf and stuff like that. But anyway, I had a lot of soul, R&B, but not a whole lot of great stuff. I already pulled some stuff from there before. I'm not sure if I showed any of that before or not, but anyway, I grabbed a few out of there, so a lot of this is, you know, the best of thrift store finds, you might say, kind of the thing. Everything was half off, but to this guy that was in there that day, half off was a dollar. So I think I paid a dollar for them before, maybe. I don't know. Maybe I paid a couple dollars for what. So it gives you an idea up front what you might find for a dollar if you look around. So anyway, before we get too far, I had a hankering for some old-fashioned drink here. Ginger beer, natural ginger, caffeine-free, which is what I need. I'm going to try my best to try to get myself off of some caffeine, sugars. I added sugars, 33 grams for a 26-inch ounce bottle. I don't know. We'll see what this... Yeah, ginger beer is not alcoholic. Of course, it wafts up. Not real strong, but a little bit. It's real kind of a flat taste. It's not like root beer. It's like ginger beer. So, not quite as good as root beer. It almost tastes medicinal. Teddy's ginger beer. You know, it tastes like a root beer kind of a thing. Almost more diety, or like a medicinal taste. If you like ginger beer, I might suggest that. Yeah, the ginger's starting to come up. It's something that it's like a burning. Anyway, my oldest son got me this blue snowball microphone for Christmas. I think it's Christmas or my birthday. Quite a while ago, at least a year ago. And I didn't have a way to plug it into my phone, of course. So months later, I bought the adapter. I went to try to go use it a couple months ago. Couldn't find the adapter anywhere. Couldn't find it anywhere. Looked all over the house. So I went ahead and bought a $10 one online. I've had good luck with $10 Belkin anyway. I don't think this is a Belkin. But they've got to be certified for their Apple DAT or whatever you want to call it that's in there. Of course, the next day, I paid $10 for that. The next day, I find the Apple dongle sitting right next to me, next to my computer, under a magazine, in one of my Salt magazines. But I could have seen it. It's right there. It's peeking out underneath that. But I ended up, for the same price, I was buying another one of those. Getting that and a digital dynamometer for my, it's basically a scale for my turntable. To get it going, anyway. Let's look at some records. First one up here, Bob James, Hands Down. It's pretty much typical smooth jazz from 1982. It's got a decent gatefold. Not really sure what this is about, but kind of a cool gatefold. Bob James plays keys, synthesizer, that kind of stuff. It's got bass, Gary King, drums, John Robinson, Steve Kahn on guitar. Actually, there's a little bit of vocals by Patty Austin, Vivian Cherry, Yvonne Lewis, Luther Vandross. There's some cool stuff in addition to the horn section and all that kind of stuff. It's decent for smooth jazz. This is the kind of stuff that I figured I'd be listening to the rest of my life when I was a teenager, you know, in the 80s. I'm looking in the future thinking, you know, kind of my dream. I'd be listening to this, to smooth jazz, whatever. Listening to jazz and drawing really cool floor plans, really cool houses for the rest of my life. And don't give up on your dreams, kids. Make it happen. Speaking of smooth jazz, Spyro Jarrah's Breakout. They're often referred to fusion. There's a little bit of electric guitar here and there, especially on one song. Some really serious electric guitar going. Yet the lead is really the saxophone, which kind of lumps them in more with Kenny G, for good reason. I mean, this is good. If you don't know Spyro Jarrah, you probably already do. It's decent for smooth jazz kind of stuff. It's a little bit edgier. It's not quite as smooth as Kenny G. It's a little, so it kind of leans a little bit fusion. Sometimes more often than not. Now, this is a second copy of this I got, but I couldn't remember what condition my other one is, and I think this is a little bit better shape. It's pretty decent shape, just a little bit of ring. Seems like it sounds good. 1977 Lake. They've got some blazing guitars and vocal harmonies. At first, Styx comes to mind, but more so, the more you listen, a little bit more Yes or Supertramp comes to mind with the keyboards. And especially, they had a hit with Time Bomb on this debut, and the vocals there really bring to mind, it might not bring to mind, but remind me of this kind of John Anderson type of Yes vocals. And it's kind of a fun song that you think John Anderson might sing. There's another real good song called Do You There you go. Do I Love You? It's a really good song. So the last song on the first side. And the second song, Jesus Came Down, is kind of an anti-war hippie song. It's talking about Jesus came down and he ain't happy. It's basically just talking about why do we kill each other and everything, goodbye y'all, kind of a thing. Decent song, decent message. Nevertheless, even, hippies weren't all wrong. Well, that's why they thought Jesus was just all right. Ray Price, Greatest Hits. This is my kind of country. Why I prefer George Strait, Dwight Yoakam, John Anderson, the country John Anderson, more than all of the new pop stuff. I really dig the fiddles and the slide guitar. That stuff's cool. This is released 1961. He was 40 years old. 20 years after the turn of the century. You can imagine how different things were when he was born and growing up. You can think of why he might know the, I was going to say the blues, it's kind of what this country music, original country music, is about, kind of having the blues, basically. You Done Me Wrong, Same Old Me, you'll be first release, Invitation to the Blues, I'll Be There When You Get Lonely, Heartache by the Number, My Shoes Keep Walking Back to You. So that's kind of a fun title, huh? And look at that fun jacket. Isn't that, what is that? I mean, come on. It's a decent cover. I don't like the colors so much. It's a little bit too much yellow, but it's a nice looking cover nevertheless. It's nice and bright and simple layout kind of stuff. This kind of does too, but this is like a sad looking 70s song, I finally picked up this Dan Hill song. Reason why, it's needs glued back together. It plays guitars on here. You might the reason, probably one and only reason to get this album is the song Sometimes When We Touch. Yeah, it's just something that, I don't know, as a collector, it's cool to have an album of a really big song from the 70s. Even if the rest of it's, I don't know, maybe I need to listen to it again. But that one song is really cool. If you like that song, Sometimes When We Touch, look that up, Dan Hill, if you're not familiar, especially girls. You'll like that. And you might really like the rest of the album. A lot of people did. It's the first song on that. Now, this is one I wasn't super familiar with. Not really a surprise, but a nice surprise, because I hadn't heard it before. Just some of the soul and R&B that they had in the stuff in the store. Tom Brown, Love Approach. If you get the plane theme, it's kind of cool, kind of classy. Putting himself in the classy jazz world there is rather nice. First song, Funkin' for Jamaica, New York. This is on GRP, Arista. That song is made it in my basketball list. It's that funky. It's co-written and sung by Toni Smith, if you know who she is. It is a number one song, Funkin' for Jamaica. Also, the last song, Weak in the Knees, is co-written and sung by Vicky Silva, who's not mentioned on here. Dave Grusin, I think produced by Dave Grusin and Larry Rosen. So, you know this is gonna be good. It's funky trumpet jazz. One song in the middle, I can't remember which one it is. I think it's the Dreams of Loving You, the last song on the first side, maybe. Reminds a lot of Chuck Mangione. It almost sounds like a Chuck Mangione song, but it's a good thing. It sounds really cool. So check this out if you might think you might be interested in some funky trumpet jazz. Rick Wakeman. If you know who Rick Wakeman is, probably do. Put out a solo album. Keyboards. This is a really strange album. It's kind of a, it's called Criminal Record, and it's kind of a dark, it's kind of a dark album in a way, with some humor, some different, this one says Judas Iscariot. The song titles, Crime of Passion, Birdman of Alcatraz. It basically goes through, and each track song is about someone with a criminal record, basically. Statue of Justice. This is red on black, so it's super hard to read. Can't remember who that's about. The Chamber of Horrors. Madame Tussauds, Waxworth. It tells a story about these different people. Birdman of Alcatraz, who I think stayed here in Leavenworth for a long time, and he ended up having a sad ending, even though he had kind of a good story, if you like birds, through the middle. The Breathalyzer is kind of a goofy song about drinking and driving. Judas Iscariot is real notable. It's, you know, obviously who Judas Iscariot is, the betrayer of Christ. They talks about that, and it's a real long orchestrated song that he does, and I can't remember if it like takes up the whole second side, basically. It's interesting. It's not great. You'd want a Rick Wakeman album to be great. You really want it to. But I think he was just having fun, obviously, just kind of having fun talking about a dark topic. And it's interesting. Maybe especially the Judas Iscariot song, if you listen to. It's more interesting if you read. That's why liner notes are nice. If you read what he's talking about, the song is about. Al Di Meola, Electric Rendezvous. I'm not sure how many copies of this I have, but just like Jean-Luc Ponte, not quite as much a fan of Al Di, really close. I mean, he's up there with some of my favorite jazz artists. This is a good copy of this, like, you know, as you can see, a little bit of ring. This is great for, as you can see, those who appreciate guitar, great guitar playing. And this isn't all electric guitar. There's some blazing electric and acoustic guitar with a Latin flavor. Electric Cat on there. It's really cool. If you're a guitar fan or want something without a bunch of lyrics to listen to in the evening while you're doing other things or whatever, this is great for that, or active listening, whatever. I'll be Neola. Take six. Doobie Doo Wop Bop. It's kind of modified doo wop for 1988, you know. If you don't know who Take Six is, it's an a cappella group. They got really big when this came out, like I said, 1988. It's got accolades by Marvin Winans, you know, BBCC Winans, you know, the Winans. Sandy Patty says something on here. It's kind of hard to read what Brian Wilson said on here. I wish I could read this. Even with my glasses, I can't read this. Anyway, it's so tiny on there, I can't read it. But basically, this is the sound of mastering the pure voice for pure reasons. I thought they might be a non-instrumental Church of Christ group, but they're Seventh-day Adventist. But they're, you know, nevertheless, they're devoted, and they're really popular. This is really popular stuff to hear on, especially Christian radio back in the day. If you want to know what Christian radio sounded like, kind of more in the beginnings of it, check out Take 6 on your Spotify. And of course, this is acapella stuff. But lyrically, you'll hear, you know, a different style maybe. And it's just, I don't know, it's cool stuff if you like acapella singing, especially. It's kind of it's doo-wop, but it's modernized for 1988. Speaking of pure motives, yeah, I picked up another one of these. It's barely on here, so let's do away with this. Just because it's barely on there. Now, you know, Herb Alpert and the Tijuana Brass. Yes, I have other Herb Alpert albums than this one. There's a story about her. I forget her name, but you can read about that. I'm sure that the sales of this catapulted his label, you know, Alpert for A&M, for Alpert. How many of these do you have? I'm planning on stopping at 100. I don't pay any more than $1 for these. This one sounds good. It's a re-release. But I'm thinking this 3, it took me a while to find which version this is. There's a little 3 down here, and I'm not sure what, if 3 is specific, I need to look that up again so I'll be able to remember it more. If I just see the 3 on there, that kind of helps you find which which comes in handy with a record with billions of variant, you know, represses out there. But I'm thinking that 3 maybe stands for 3D, since this cover is printed a little bit off and to where it almost has a 3D look. So this is one of the ones that I have that's in better shape, really nice shape, but not as good a printing on that. Johnny Mathis. Yeah, you can find these anywhere. This is in really nice shape, so I picked it up. I just think these have really nice covers. It's pleasant to listen to. It's real nicely laid out. Of course, you can't read this blue text up here, but that's okay because it's just a record label logo. And that's a good thing that you can't see it too well. But nicely done. Looks like airbrush. I don't know if it's airbrush. It's what year was this? I'm not sure. But it could have been, I suppose. But just really pleasant listening. Had to pick up another Johnny Mathis for some reason. Now, when you drop the diamond on this record, the title song fancifully dances out of the speakers, asking you to go beyond the simplicity of the phrase, and Frankie's singing about really living. It really sounds like a classy and swanky 007 theme song, actually. Now, there's a couple of westernish tracks on here, yet despite his appearance, Most of this sounds more like Sinatra, Nat King Cole, or Mathis. Let's see. The standout track, I believe, I couldn't remember which one, sounds a lot like Elvis. And it reminds one that standing before God, no one will have a legitimate excuse based upon, first of all, God puts knowledge of himself inside everyone anyway. Kind of pre-programmed to know our maker, basically. But just looking in nature, you know, everything was made. You know, things by themselves don't make themselves. Somebody's got to design them, right? It's just based on that. You look at your kid and you say, there is a God, you know, that kind of thing. But anyway, that's kind of what the song is pretty much saying. Frankie Lane's charm is his upbeat, dramatic, jazzy rhythm in his singing style. And I almost didn't pick this up because it wasn't super country like I was anticipating it to be. But listening to it, it just made this nice looking cover kind of unfortunate in a way. A Friend We Have. It's an interesting title. Does a song come to mind when you see that? Now, if you're familiar with some guy back in the day that I already mentioned, some guy named Elvis, you should be familiar with the Jordanaires. Named after the biblical river, or some say it was a river or creek or whatever near Springfield, Missouri, where the Jordanaires were from, Springfield, Missouri, or Branson area, that kind of thing. Also, my youngest son is named Jordan, named after you're waiting for that to happen, weren't you? Made it happen for you. Anyway, I always thought that my parents should have named me Ernie, since they named my brother Bert. You know, why didn't they name me Ernie? You know. Speaking of goofy people named Ernie, if you've ever seen I Love Lucy, you might have seen season 3, episode 28. Uncle Ernie comes to visit, and of course, it's I Love Lucy, so it's super funny. But Ernie's deep baritone, and the quartet is backed by a light piano and organ, and acoustic guitar and bass, just kind of filling the air around the voices. Sounds really cool. This is in real nice shape. I love the 60s, 50s, 40s. I love the old sounds. Franny Gold. Now, I was hoping this was going to be more disco than it is. Just a little bit of disco. It's more pop and R&B. I think what she did is she saved all her best music that she wrote for other artists that she's written for. Diana Ross, Whitney Houston, Christina Aguilera, Pussycat Dolls. Lots of soundtracks. You'll see her name in a bunch of soundtracks. It's got a nice gatefold. You know, I mean, I don't really care for the cover too much. It's nicely done. It's well done. It's a good idea. The picture inside's a bit nicer, and she still pretty much looks like that. I don't know what year this is. So like it's 80-something. Anyway, it's mid-80s probably. It's disco days. She does a version of All We Need Is Love, and especially for a while into the song, you wouldn't know that it's a Beatles song. which is kind of a good thing. But, you know, if you're girls out there, you might be interested in her fancy pants line. If you go on FrannyGold.com, order you up some of her fancy, supposed to be the best black pants you could buy. I don't know. I probably should have left that one in the store. Yep. You might have noticed this is another copy I bought of this. I bought another copy of this probably just last year. I came across one. This is a great collaboration between Brent Bourgeois and Larry Tagg. They kind of share equal writing credit. Larry sings on three of the songs. One of the more memorable ones is Waiting for the Worm to Turn. That kind of, you know, puts an earworm in your head. Let's see, what's wrong with this picture? I believe was written by, co-written with Charlie Peacock. If you know anything about these guys, you probably know who Charlie Peacock is. It actually reminds me a little more of Steve Taylor, actually, because this guy just, the sound is a little more humorous. Which, you know, reminds me there's a new Chagall Gravera album out, so, hey, Larry and Brent, you might, jump on that bandwagon. Let's see. What's Wrong with This Picture is, I believe that's kind of co-written by Larry's brother, Eric, who's a musician down in Texas, a Christian artist. It's actually also co-written by jazz guitar virtuoso Lyle Workman. You might check his stuff out. It's really cool. Jazz fusion, basically. It's jazz guitar for the most part. I don't mind it at all. Is probably, that's co-written also by Lyle Workman, I believe. That's probably one of the most Beatlesque songs, I don't mind at all, that you'll hear out there. Very Beatlesque, and it's about all I can handle for that year of Beatles song. But these guys do such a great job of some of that style. And of course Todd Rundgren did a great job of producing this album. So anyway, check out Bourgeois Tag. It's still relevant sounding. Now, with a name like Hank and a title like this, Broken Heart of Mine, you know what to expect. This could become one of my favorite country albums, with some smooth, smooth swing sounds of the Brassos, what they call the Brassos Valley Boys, who, they're a group in Oklahoma. They're still going. Of course, there's newer members. You know, it's been so many years. Playing their fiddles and jazz steel guitar. Come to think of it, I guess I kind of prefer Western music over country music, if you know what I mean. Once again, a great, really nice looking cover. Well done. Both sides. I like the black and white back. Kind of tells you kind of money was spent, you know. I guess you call those the tip on or whatever sheets glued over the card stock. Nice cover. Great sounding. I was going to say, if you like country music, this is maybe what you'd call Western music, and it's more deep, you know, deep country, you know. She's a girl without any sweetheart. So he's not talking about himself. He's talking about a sad situation with someone else, which is a different, you know. But take a look at this broken heart of mine. Love thief. Soft lips. Give little, take little. Hangover heart. Those things money can't buy. You know, once again, you know, country thoughts. It's really good. Really good album. And lastly, Foggy River Boys. Not the Foggy or the Foggy River Boys. It's Foggy River Boys. Now, lead singer Rob Hubbard here, as you can see, got his name on there, is the main connection to the original 1940s group, which later became the aforementioned Jordanaires. As you can see, this is a 70s group. You can see the glasses, the suits, the colors, the yellows, and the blue, and the songs that they're covering. Candyman, Mr. Bojangles, Delta Dawn, Yellow Tie, Yellow Ribbon. Yeah. That's the signature of the 70s. I'm trying to imagine who would love, who would be, you know, ecstatic about going to see the Foggy River Boys. I love gospel music, which is what this originated as, but 30 years later, you know, what they're covering some pop songs, you know, in their 70s manner. Now, I've been trying to figure out who this John something signature is. The Joe Bean over here is the drummer. But I haven't been able to figure out who. I guess it's John Betaco or something. I don't know. Don't know who that signature is. But there's others that have a different signature other than Koontz here. What's his name? Denzel Koontz. I wonder if he's related to one of my ex-girlfriend. I don't know. It's an odd name, but this actually has his signature instead of someone else's up here. You have any idea who this John guy was? Probably the soundboard guy or something. But I haven't been able to find out who this is, but looking online, I'm wondering who this, I haven't been able to find any names, let alone any lineage to this new Branson trio is. I don't know, called the Foggy, not the, they're called Foggy River Boys. And yeah, they got a modern upbeat thing and, you know, singing Back in Time, which is what an appropriate song. It reminds me of the show you go to at Worlds of Fun over here, the amusement park, and go see a show where they're all synchronized dancing and everything, singing songs from the past, and you know, you get all excited because this group is singing songs from your past or whatever. That's basically what they're doing. With there's three guys with four or five whatever girls dancing around them. They're all just doing this choreography on stage. It's something to go see at Branson, I guess. I don't know if you're into that. We've gone from the gospel to the girls, right? What are things coming to? Anyway, don't forget to like and subscribe. I'm trying to do all kinds of different music, obviously, and I've got Record Store Day stuff coming up and a whole bunch of, I've got a stack of videos that I hope to get to someday. I mean, some of them I've been working on for years, actually. It is pretty sad, but anyway, I spend way too much time just making these things. Anyway, this is Steve the Salt Zine. Thanks for coming. Now, don't forget to like and to subscribe and hit that bell or whatever. But go out there, as always say, use what God gave you to do something cool for someone else. Right on. Right on.